All right, so hi, welcome to the LaRouche PAC event from Alameda, California. My name is Michael Steger. We are live on the web for some of the locations in Seattle and Los Angeles, as well as those just listening via YouTube and so on. We held this event. We decided to at the end of last week, given the rate of development of a historical situation. And so what I'd like to do is situate the discussion for today and what the historical process is. What are we actually looking at now, today, in terms of a rapidly changing global condition? And the nature of it is that it's one in flux. There's one not of a fixed characteristic. So any conclusions of a pessimistic or naively optimistic nature would be false. We are at a great turning point for mankind. And the deliberations and discussions here are meant to facilitate what we would identify as the causal process that determines the development of mankind as a species. And by participating in discussions of this nature, you're participating in that which is responsible for mankind's voluntary evolution. So, in saying such, let me read something from the recent Executive Intelligence Review magazine. This is a thoroughly composed political document that comes out weekly, and it is of extraordinary historical significance. This is the title of this one is We Are All Greeks, which has even probably greater truth, or as much truth as when Percy Shelley said this in the early 19th century. With a special editorial, Free the Pope from Satan. Now, this is an essay, which was the introduction to a play called The Bride of Messina by Friedrich Schiller. And I read it because the content of our discussion today is exemplary of what Schiller identified, who not only as a great tragedian and playwright, a renowned and probably one of the most profound poets, a poet that had the depth of emotion and insight to inspire people like Beethoven and others to even elevate their understanding of mankind into a kind of a revolutionary creative identity. And in this essay, he wrote, it's entitled On the Employment of the Chorus in Tragedy. And I think you'll find relevance to it in terms of the political situation, but also then in terms of the presentations given today. I'm just going to read a few sentences. I'm not going to be exhaustive with quotes. He says, a poetical work, and this is how he begins, a poetical work must justify itself. And where the deed does not speak, words will not be to much avail. One might well, therefore, leave it to the chorus to be its own spokesman, were it for once given the appropriate form of representation. And then he says, to do justice to the chorus, therefore, one must transpose oneself from the actual state to a possible one. But one must do that everywhere where one intends to achieve something higher. That which art still lacks, that it is to obtain. The fortuitous lack of resources must not be permitted to constrain the creative power of the imagination of the poet. He sets himself the most worthy as his goal. He strives toward the ideal. The practicing artist, the practical artist, may accommodate himself to the circumstances. It is not true, as one usually hears the claim made, that the audience degrades art. The artist degrades the audience. And at all times when art degenerated, it fell because of the artists. Now, this question of the chorus has been raised by Mr. LaRouche before in terms of an historical process. So it is something of how history works. And Shakespeare's maybe perhaps greatest history play, Henry V, was entirely shaped by the role of the chorus from opening to closing and throughout the play. Because oftentimes what shapes history is what's beyond the events one sees, beyond the events on stage. But there is a process, and that process is knowable. And to the extent that you have individuals who grasp that process and act upon it with a certain courage or passion for truth, you then have an ability, I think as Shakespeare would agree or identify, to affect that process, to escape the tragedy, which is what we must do. So I'm not going to go through the long list of the characteristics of tragedy. I can make a short list, though. In the United States, you have now the blatant, what was always perhaps there but unidentified, but now blatant collaboration between the most vicious and nasty factions in the Republican Party, which largely dominate the Republican Party and nearly all of their presidential candidates, with directly the Obama administration. So the cat and mouse game that you saw theatrically displayed on mass media for the last 7 years was a hypocritical fraud of the most severe degree. And what these two factions in American politics, which are essentially one faction, a treasonous faction run by Wall Street, run by this hardcore war program, a military-industrial complex, as Eisenhower identified, they have now just moved for massive dictatorship. They are purging, under Boehner's or Boehner's leadership in the Republican House, purging any Republicans who disagree with Obama, purging them from any committee or subcommittee leadership position. And you see Obama consolidating what has always been intended with his presidency and was intended for the Bush presidency, which is a form of dictatorship to destroy the American Republic and its Constitution and extinguish any possibility of the United States collaborating with other great nations for global development. And in hopes, with intent, to destroy that potential for global development. To crush the nations like China or Russia from participating in a collaborative effort of development. To crush nations like Brazil, who are now moving in the direction of Russia and China with the BRICS. That has been in the intent. That has been the intent the entire time. Obamacare was indeed a Republican policy to begin with, and it was vicious. It was based on a principle of cost analysis of healthcare or mass killing of people, the most weak and vulnerable. So not surprising that the most right-wing fanatics on the Supreme Court are the ones to endorse that Obamacare, because indeed they support its effect. They might not support its propaganda as a socialist medicine, but they do endorse the intent that it will kill the most vulnerable of the American people. So we need some major changes to the federal government. We need it now. We need a functioning presidency, and we need it now. Not in 2016, not in January of 2017, but in the weeks ahead. Now, in addition to that political process in the United States, there is a response. And that response is now coming from those Republicans who are recognizing that there is no opposition. The only legitimate basis the Republican Party has for its existence is the fact that it's not Obama. So there now is a revolt within some Republicans. Is that significant? I'm not here to speculate. I'm not going to give it much confidence. Is there anger and frustration by Democrats who feel betrayed time and time again by Obama against basic principles of Franklin Roosevelt or John Kennedy or just basic common good? Yes, there's anger and frustration from Democrats. It's explicit Obama has compromised anything that he promised to stand for. Is that significant? It is. Is it sufficient? I wouldn't speculate that it is. But it is a context by which political change can and indeed must happen. Now, but the crisis is much more beyond the United States. The economic crisis is severe. The drought in California is massive. And most people there in California are coming to just accept the terms. Though the terms, as was put by an assembly member we talked to this week, what do people do without food and water? He had a military background. So the first three things you learn in the military is the three things necessary for survival are food, water, and shelter. So he's recognizing that the state of California is violating two of the three principal factors of survival. Oh, maybe Mexico can grow our food. That seems to be a bit of an absurd notion. Maybe China can grow our food. Again, these things seem to be absurd. And are. But this is how people talk. This is what people say. They say these things. Oh, well, we'll get food somewhere else. But where? When? The drought is severe. California youth unemployment is near 50%. There's a devastation to the economy. People work 6-7 days a week. Many people we talk to on the phones as a political movement now work more and more for less and less and aren't surviving. That's just what we're facing in the American population. But the stock market keeps rising, so there's so-called an economic recovery. But the crisis is far more than just the United States. Besides the kind of destruction you've seen in Mexico and South America, you see a kind of crisis which is undermining any moral foundation in Europe. We've bombed countries like Libya. We've bombed countries and incited civil war in countries like Sudan. We've bombed or destroyed and facilitated terrorism to take over countries like Syria. You have now tens of thousands of people a week on small flotillas trying to make it into Europe for their own survival from these areas. And many of them are drowning in the Mediterranean Sea. Or if they survive, they're used for some kind of financial gain, but denied access to any decent human life. You have young children who survived the Nazi concentration camps who now live in Europe, and they see the conditions of these people. They see their physical condition. They see their living conditions. And it's impossible not to remember what was done to the Jews during World War II. This is the condition now happening. You have the situation in Ukraine, where a similar kind of process has been imposed upon the people of Eastern Ukraine. But there also is a threat of nuclear war. And what has happened over the last week or so, but it has been a process for maybe the last half a year or longer, is that a pope came into power, I guess if you call it power, representation, but it's essentially a position of power, now Pope Francis, who had spoken a concern for the poor, and essentially decided to challenge the so-called international economic system based on money, which was, of course, there is an idolatry of money. And it is, in essence, evil. It is, in essence, pure corruption of the human population and of our systems of government. But there was an influence on this papacy of the most, you could say, satanic form. There's a member of the British Order of the Empire, commander of the British Empire, a guy named Hans Schellenhuber, who in 2009 at the Copenhagen Climate Summit declared that it's now proven that the Earth's carrying capacity is known to be less than 1 billion people. And this figure, a major proponent for massive population reduction, has been the principal authors, if not the principal author, of the recent papal encyclical, Laudate Si. And this is his philosophical outlook has now taken over the papacy. So hence the editorial from our EIR, free the Pope from Satan, because that's literally what we must do. I want to read people just a sense of this, and I want to give a sense of the kind of decline that's taken place over the last 50 years in terms of our outlook and why this encyclical is so dangerous to mankind. Now, he starts out in this encyclical and he says, Laudato si, mi signore. Praise be to you, my Lord. In the words of this beautiful canticle, St. Francis of Assisi reminds us that our common home is like a sister with whom we share our life and a beautiful mother who opens her arms to embrace us. Quote, praise be to you, my Lord, through our sister, Mother Earth, who sustains and governs us and who produces various fruit with colored flowers and herbs. The second section says, this sister now cries out to us because of the harm we have inflicted on her by our irresponsible use and abuse of the goods with which God has endowed her. We have come to see ourselves as her lords and masters, entitled to plunder her at will. The violent present The violent, present in our hearts, wounded by sin, is also reflected in the symptoms of sickness, evident in the soil, in the water, in the air, and in all forms of life. This is why the earth herself, burdened and laid waste, is among the most abandoned and maltreated of our poor. She groans in travail. We have forgotten that we ourselves are dust of the earth. Our very bodies are made up of her elements. We breathe her air, and we receive life and refreshment from her waters. Nothing in this world is indifferent to us. Now, many people will say to themselves, many people have, many people are, what was true? Look what we've done to the earth. But I'm sure that if you take a second to reflect, you would find that these kind of sentiments and the effect of these sentiments would be entirely consistent with the Dark and Middle Ages, where mankind was treated as dust of the earth, that the majority of people were treated like beasts who should do as little as possible and be told what to do and to live their life in a condition of slavery and burden, with no sense of humanity, no sense of dignity, no sense of creativity or scientific advance. That's what this expresses. And the justification is our Mother Earth is in pain. She is, as he says, the most abandoned and maltreated of our poor. I'd be hard-pressed to say that the poor and maltreated of our earth are somehow in a better condition than what this expresses. Now, I want to give a different sentiment. This is from the encyclical letter of His Holiness Pope Paul VI, Populorum Progressio, on the development of peoples. The date, maybe someone else knows the date. The date isn't here. I think
it's either 66 or 67.
Right, so it's sometime in the mid to late mid-60s. He says, he begins, the development of peoples has the church's close attention, particularly the development of those peoples who are striving to escape from hunger, misery, endemic diseases, and ignorance, of those who are looking for a wider share in the benefits of civilization and a more active improvement of their human qualities, of those who are aiming purposefully at their completed fulfillment. Following on the Second Vatican Ecumenical Council, a renewed consciousness of the demands of the gospel makes it her duty to put herself at the service of all, to help them grasp their serious problem in all its dimensions, and to convince them that solidarity in action at this turning point in human history is a matter of urgency. Now, he says more. It's a fairly remarkable kind of optimistic statement. He says at the end of the first section, we consider it our duty to set up a pontifical commission in the church's central administration, charged with, quote, bringing to the whole of God's people the full knowledge of the part expected of them at the present time, so as to further the progress of poorer peoples, to encourage social justice among nations, to offer to less developed nations the means whereby they can further their own progress. Its name, which is also its program, is justice and peace. We think that this can and should bring together men of goodwill with our Catholic sons and our Christian brothers. So it is to all that we address this solemn appeal for concrete action towards man's complete development and the development of all mankind. Now that's the sentiments of someone dedicated to developing all of God's creation, including that which is probably most unique, which is the human species, which has the ability to not only conceive of our earth, which, I'll be honest with you, there's an obsession with the earth. The earth is part of a solar system, which is fairly remarkable and fairly knowable, has been for about 400 years, and should be discovered by more people. That solar system is part of a galaxy, which is also knowable, yet still to be defined in many ways. And so perhaps we should be a little bit less object fixated about Mother Earth and consider about the state of our solar system, of our galaxy, and mankind's role within it. Why is this important? Because we are at a deciding point. given the tragedy and destruction of the population that we see on the planet today, we also see a remarkable potential. And that's the nature of the discussion today. Because as I put on the board, we have 2 dates. A week from tomorrow, the Greek prime minister, the Greek government, has called for a popular referendum to discuss what is a fascist and inhuman proposal by the European banks and institutions. Will they accept that fascist proposal of death to more Greeks, more rapid death to the Greeks, or will they reject it? And if they reject it, which is very likely that they will, because over 60% are already in favor of rejecting it, regardless of the consequences of getting kicked out of the European Union, and the government also proposes it, it changes much of the dynamic of the global financial system, because the bluff is being called. There is no value to this debt. There is no value to this system. The system itself is bankrupt. It's morally bankrupt. There's a difference between financial and moral bankruptcy, and this system is both. Now, following July 5th, which is the popular referendum, the BRICS, the nations dedicated to Pope Paul's perhaps view of how we address problems, is meeting in Russia. Ufa, which is an area southeast Russia near the Ural Mountains, on July 9th. And they've already invited Greece to participate in the development of the BRICS new financial system, which is in essence a new global financial system. This is now within the weeks ahead of us. And this system is bankrupt. Now, Mr. LaRouche has called, and it's a very obvious, it's an obvious but yet interesting call, of the U.S. Congress to reject this dictatorship push by Republicans and Obama should move immediately for Glass-Steagall. The best way to disrupt this coup takeover of the United States by the Bush, Cheney, Obama takeover of U.S. policy is to go to Glass-Steagall immediately. Call a margin call on all of the fraudulent debt. Flush it. Flush this. End the power of Wall Street and London banks. End the power of Draghi and the European financial institutions. Establish a debt conference. Write off the illegitimate debt, which is exactly what Glass-Steagall would do. And establish a new banking and credit system for the deployment and employment of the populations of our world. And that's exactly what the BRICS will be discussing. And it will be the BRICS, the five nations. It will be the nations of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which includes all of Central Asia, as well as Pakistan and Iran and India. And it will also include the Eurasian Economic Union, which includes Armenia, under attack right now, and Belarus. So we are looking at a culminating point, but one of which is shaped by a question of ideas and the nature of man. The solutions are available. The solutions are available in the United States to change our government. As desperate and as imperiled as times seem, the solutions exist. What is lacking is a conception and optimism of the human mind and of mankind that brings those solutions to bear, a kind of courage and a passion for truth. That exists now in places like China and India. It exists in places like Russia more than it does here or in most of Europe. If nations like Germany, which has seen recent revolts, breaks from this tyranny and works with Russia, opens up trade with Russia, everything could drastically change in similar course. And so these next weeks ahead are of critical significance. And the question is, are you going to abide by a view that our greatest concern is not the course of mankind and its development, but all of a sudden should be neglect that entirely? Our greater concern should be to take care of the deserts of California and ensure that they remain and become greater desert. Or is it one of mankind's future? That is the question they're asking. That's what's posed by these two different systems. And it's a view of mankind, and it's a view of culture. And that makes politics. This now, I would say, is the stage of real politics. how do we shape this view of human identity, of the human mind, and enrich it? And I think Friedrich Schiller would agree, and so would we. So I'm going to leave that the political briefing at that point. If there aren't any questions on any of this, I'll take a few questions. Just if people have urgency on the particular political situation, because there are some complexities, but it's also, as things often are, as they get more complex, they also become more simple. Shana, did you have a question?
No,
okay.
Great.
Brian, did you have something?
Hi, Mike.
Hi.
Yes, sir. I just kind of wondered about the transition that would take place from IMF to the Federal Reserve. Our money system, Obama's got this bill that passed years ago, the effect of July 1, 2014, official U.S. dollar collapse. Few people are aware of that. Now, if the transition takes place, of course, you know, make it so. It's got, you know, Star Trek to say, make it so. At some point, where along this transition, it would be worthless. And that's a change is made. And the BRICS will embrace the idea of the BRICS. The hope is, we get in the BRICS before that was to happen, the war happened. And make a transition, rather go with the useless, I mean, five money system. How are we gonna, like, day to day, go to store and buy something, you know, gas, food, rent, house payment, whatever it might be, plumbing.
Well, this is the importance of having Obama's removal.
Yes.
Because all of that is made possible by a commitment to the long-term survival of the nation and of population. The money has value because of that. The reason the dollar is strong is because the commitment to the future development of mankind was greatest in the United States and was most capable within the United States following World War II. That's what made the money so dominant. Not because the money somehow had some big backing of gold or anything of that nature. It was because the actual power to act for the improvements and development of the population, technologically, the advancement of the technology of production was greatest in the United States, that you made that possible. It's the reason why Germany is so critical to the question of Europe. It's why China has become so critical to the planet as a whole. So it's fundamentally that commitment, and then the ability to harness that commitment and the powers of production. Those two things are what give money its value, and it gives the financial system any stability. And in a sense, we lose the functioning of the system. So it's a function of government today, and that's why Obama's removal is the most critical.
Of course, that's essential. But the dollar, that bill is in the Congress, even if he's not off, it will still be there. That should be able to reverse, at least temporarily, until the BRICS come in and make the transition. That bill is H.R. 2847. I'm not sure what year. I know in 2010 they're working on it, and it's going to affect 2014, July 1, and it's going to transition all up to 2017 or 18 different states. It's necessary for Americans hiding money offshore, but it would be in a lot of sub-hit, and that's a part of it.
Yeah.
If that bill was to reverse, like Glass-Steagall, 1933 to 99, with Clinton, the ability said, we're done with that. And then if we reinstate that, this new bill in the Congress to reinstate it, then with some new guidelines, slightly different than what it was before, to keep commercial banks from taking money and investment banks. That process, the same idea can deal with that. And then the dollar system should be able to reverse that. The bill H.R. 2847, when it was enacted last summer, the part about the money pushing collapsing and now it's solid, the temporary term of transition and tell the BRICS and get all their ducks lined up and make the changes.
Yeah, I agree. And those kinds of steps need to be taken. The question is,
what are you doing?
Well, it is. It's a question of not having the legislation there or the technical factors. The technical features are not there. It's a question of how do you bring to bear the commitment in this direction. And it is not a fight. The fight is not located. And the biggest problem we face, as many people here I'm sure know, because as you talk to people about this political situation, you realize that to the extent they're fixated on the United States, they miss the ability to win the war. Though the United States is critical to winning, it is not where the war is fought. It's a global strategic situation. The United States presidency, the potential to change the presidency and remove Obama in the coming weeks is happening in Greece and in Russia. And to the extent we can influence that. And the question that comes up is not that you decide today to influence those questions. The point we're making is that we've largely shaped, as an organization, the development of this process. These singularities now exist as a process that have gone on for approximately 25 years, since the fall of the wall.
I see. And with Obama's removal from office, it would take the kinkas up underneath him and the process of the move to drag us in World War III against Russia and China. That would be gone too.
Right. If there isn't a move to remove Obama and implement Glass-Steagall, then we do face the threat of war, because the only opportunity this empire has to sustain its existence is to destroy the viability of the BRICS.
Right. And that old thinking, we're about to sit at World War II, the general warfare is obsolete in the atomic warfare, and now we're way in part in advance of that new system. So,
good.
Hope for the best, and hope we're successful.
Good.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah. Are there any other questions? Okay. Then let me introduce the speakers for today's discussion. I'll let them take it away. Mindy Pechnik's been working with Mr. LaRouche and a collaborator on the questions of music and culture, as well as the political revolution, for
40 years.
Over 40 years. And Mikhail Steger's been working with Mr. LaRouche and this organization for now 13 years. And I think you'll be provoked by their discussion. And so I introduce Mindy Pechnik.
And I hope everybody is provoked. All right. I want to situate a few things, and then everybody in the audience is going to have to do some work for this part, both of our parts of the presentation. Mm-hmm. And we want to leave enough time for a lot of questions. So I'm not going to cover everything that's in the EIR, which I do recommend everybody read, that we put out on what we're going to hit on today. But I want to situate, first of all, for LaRouche, it was Linda LaRouche, it was always the question from day one, which was to put together a movement that was going to create a renaissance, that finally was going to get a human identity back to humanity. And an identity which thought about and lived in the domain of the future, the domain of the real immortality of the human species. Now, our enemies of the British Empire today and empires earlier, they had to go to warfare against that identity. And the most deadly way they went for warfare against that identity was through culture, was through the power of music, art, poetry, drama, to get people to think completely opposite of everything that is actually true. As Bertrand Russell once said, if you can get people to believe that snow is black, then you don't need armies, you know, or policemen. And one of the most direct accesses to the human soul is music. It's an unspeakable language that is a language, a means of communication of the most powerful ideas of beauty and truth. So if you want to know truth and beauty, you have to really know what Bach discovered, what Mozart took up, what Beethoven, Brahms, Schumann, Schubert. Hmm? And, you know, if you look back to the death of Kennedy, to JFK, to both Bobby and JFK, we're mostly familiar with what was brought in with the rock, drug, sex counterculture. But there was a level of operation that even made that possible. And that's why Mr. LaRouche wanted this discussion of what happened at the turn of the 20th century. Because the last living great classical composer that existed died in 1897, Brahms. Hmm? And Brahms was you have to understand, he was in a tremendous battle against Wagner, against Liszt, against all the philosophies of Satan that existed, Mahler and others in his time. And once Brahms was dead, 1897, the British Empire took off to make sure that the nobility of the creative mind of man was never known again. And this actually started a little earlier, and I'm not going to go through all the arcs of history because we can go all the way back to the fight between Bach and Rameau, but I'm not going to do that today. But it was in 1890 that was the turning point for what happened after Brahms was dead. It was the political removal of Bismarck by the British Empire as Chancellor of Germany, and it was the assassination of Sardi Carnot in 1890 in France. He was the president of France at the time. And it was his assassination, with Bismarck's removal, that made possible everything that happened into the 20th century, including World War I. And what you had happened culturally and musically, with what the enemy had, the British Empire had to create, was the idea of the rugged individual, the practical man, the pragmatic man. That's what they had to create. Because you had practical people, pragmatic people, people just say, well, it's just about me. It's about my life. I can make it no matter what. Then what has happened to the immortality of the human species? And the subject of great classical composition is the subject of creating a humanity which actually knows the immortality of the whole human species, and that your life is a contribution toward that immortality of the species. And there's a specific, you know, principles that has been developed. You can go back to Plato, through Kuza, to Leibniz, and I want everybody to keep in mind Leibniz, and I'll come back to him in a little bit, a few minutes. So what I want to do is actually to get at this, rather than do a lot of talking for the moment, is to use some musical examples. But to start with, I'm not going to tell you, I'm going to play you two examples. I'm just going to call them example A and example B. It is, I'll tell you this much, it's the same, I'm going to use the Mozart Requiem, which was the last piece Mozart composed. He actually died while he was still writing it. And it is about not mourning the dead in the way most people think, crying and other things, but it's about the celebration of life. It's about the celebration that, what did you do with your life while you lived? What did you do with that life that made a difference on humanity 100, 200, 300, 400,000 years from now? In that sense, then, when somebody dies, you celebrate his life. You look at the beauty of that life and what it's given to future generations, because in essence, then that life has never died. Physically, yes, you're dead, but in terms of the spiritual, in terms of what it is to actually be a creative person. Because the universe is creative, contrary to the new satanic encyclical of the British Empire. The universe is constantly creating. It's going to higher orders, higher energy densities. And man's mind is that which is invariant to that process. So I'm going to start with the Mozart Requiem. And I'm going to use the section called the Lacrimosa, and which is, on that day of tears and judgment, spare us by your mercy. Grant them eternal rest. That's the Lacrimosa, Dies Irae. But I'm going to use two different conductors to do it. One who represents the embodiment of a lot of the evil that you all know today. He was a project of this whole project of the 1890s. You know, he's somebody that, I'll tell you who it is, that much I'll tell you. It's Leonard Bernstein. Okay? And he's a project of everything that went into the turn of the century to create evil. I know some people may be upset that I'm attacking Bernstein, but such is life. And, you know, in the beginning, in the 1890s, Brahms had a lot of his friends come to the United States. people like Henschel, who was a baritone and also became the first conductor, I believe, of the Boston Symphony. I think he was the first. And he came over to Boston in the tradition of Brahms to conduct the Boston Symphony. And then another good friend who became the teacher of, there's three surviving people of the 19th century Dark Age Satanism. One of them was Lyndon LaRouche. One of them was Wilhelm Furtwängler, whom we will talk more about, the great conductor. And the third person was Norbert Breinin, the first violinist of the Amadeus Quartet, who was a dear friend directly of Lyndon LaRouche. But you had this battle. If you want it, and I want to make the point that the subject of going through this is actually your own minds, our own minds. Why is it that we think the way we think? What controls the way that we think? What controls what we have as opinions versus truth? Or prejudices versus truth? And it is this destruction at the turn of the century in science, in music, in every aspect, you know, of life, that you got, this is where we have, you wonder why, you know, we don't have tens of thousands of Americans out in the streets like you have Greeks right now. You know, well, this is why. It was the turn of the century destruction of culture. You wonder why everybody complains, well, my friends are stupid or my family doesn't get it, right? You know, well, this is why. And you have to look in your own mind and soul. We all do. Every one of us, me, every one of us, has to always look at our own mind and soul and think about, where do I hold back? Why am I not thinking correctly? Why do I try? And the answer is in this classical culture. And so the takeover and the fight for American actual classical composition, the early part of the century, was a fight. Because the Boston Symphony was quickly taken over by the British Empire. You know, I wouldn't even give them the decency of calling them conductors. And there was a line of them that eventually trained Leonard Bernstein as one of the inputs into him. You know, the other Lacrimosa I'm going to play is done by our movement. When we did the celebration of Kennedy's 50th, of his death, yeah. We did it once in Virginia, and then we did it once in Boston. I'm going to use the Boston performance. But we did it at the very church where they had the commemoration for Kennedy 50 years ago. Now, I'm not going to tell you which one I'm doing first. I want you to think about when you hear them. I'll play you both examples. And I want you to think in your own mind, and I want some people to come up and say what they think, or, you know, because you should use it as a test to think about what is really truthful, what is really, and there is a standard of truth. So, Wes, why don't you play example A? Thank you. Oh, did you want? Okay, you can cut it.
No, I thought you were making.
Oh, no, keep going. Sorry. Okay, now we're going to go to example B. Same piece, same Lacrimosa, same Mozart. Okay, you want to hear the first one, the first few measures of the first one again, just to compare?
Sure.
go back to example A, just play the opening part, we'll play as well. Just the opening. It's right after this. It's a little bit after this.
All right, there you go. Okay.
Example B, just that part. Then we'll open it up. And this is example B. Volunteers, what they think, okay.
I would say that with example A, that at least the pace of it was, my ears, it just sounded smoother. The notes just seemed to kind of flow better, whereas example B, it seemed rushed, and it kind of created a sense of agitation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm not going to say, okay, if people can come up front here so people who are listening on the web can hear. You want to come up here, Ed, or?
Yeah.
Okay, and then Don, after Ed, Don, you go.
I like the first one.
And it sounded like the second one, there was a lot of drastic changes in level. Whereas the first one didn't have so many. However, it flowed better. And all of the instruments seemed to harmonize better and take you with them as they went through the music. It's the only way I could put it.
Okay.
But I did definitely like the first one better.
Okay, good. I'm not saying yet which is which yet. Okay.
I did like the second one. There was one part in the first one that was screechy.
Mm-hmm.
There was a dissonance there, and then bang! Mm-hmm. Instead of it letting the you know, the chorus take over, it was that the instruments were competing with it, and I felt a sense of breathing during the second one.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So okay. Good. I'm not saying yet. Don,
I could be wrong.
Just
repeat it what you said, Chayton, one more time. Oh, what Chayton has said was she liked the second one better because it allowed her to breathe with the ideas, if I'm putting it. You got the sense of breath with the ideas. Where in the first one, there were moments where it was too screechy, right? And it was just like coming down on you versus this kind of growth. And am I putting it?
Yeah, that's right. To me, it was softer and gentler.
She said she thought the second one was softer and gentler. Okay, Don, did you want to come up? Come up here, those
yeah,
people on the webcam.
It seemed like, I think it was one of them, it seems like the performers were more...
Turn around, you got to face the camera. There's a camera over here, so people on the internet...
You want me to be on the camera?
Yeah.
In one of them, it seemed like the performers were kind of straining to make the pitch and stuff. And in the other one, it seemed like the performers were more with the music type of thing.
Which one did you think they were straining?
Well, one of them was like louder. I think that was the second one.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the first one, I sometimes get confused between one of another. I'm not a musician.
All right. That's good.
But it was one of them where they were straining, and the other one felt like, you know, they were more it felt like they were, you know, more with the music instead of straining to perform the music.
Mm-hmm.
I think people are more in tune with how the performer's performance anxiety is. I don't know how you describe it, but if you're not anxious when you're trying to perform and you're just doing it, it's different than if you're trying to do something that's, you know, a higher pitch.
Good. Anybody else?
Carol?
I just have a real simple impression. The first one seemed sad, and the second one seemed happy.
Okay, good. So, I think it's very good. I think all the responses are really, really good. Because, look, it gets at the question, what is the real intention? Because you think about it, the words are the same in both versions. It was the same text. It was the same notes on the score, the same notes written in the page by Mozart. So why were the two entirely different? And that's where you get at the real core of intention, the intention of the mind, the intention of what is true. And it shows you that it's a question, and Miwa was going to take this up, so I'm not going to, in her presentation, of, you know, what is really, and this gets, I guess, the idea of Kuzin and Leibniz, too. What is it in an idea that creates a leap in your mind? That it's not in any of the predicates itself. There's a leap Mozart has made, and that's a whole other class, so I'm not going to do that now. But what the first one was, anybody want to say who they thought it was?
Bernstein.
No.
Yeah.
Bad.
No. Bernstein. It was Bernstein.
The first one was Bernstein?
First one was Bernstein. The first one was Bernstein. And the second one was our performance in Boston.
Really?
Of the Lacrimosa at the lower tuning. Bernstein's performance is. What?
Because I thought there was a lot more tension in the first one.
It was tension, but it was
different.
The wrong tension. It was definitely a tension.
Like there was a lot of tension, a lot of stuff, and the second one just seemed like it was too melodic.
No, if you actually, well, listen to it again once. I'm going to play that just the beginning once more.
Well, this shows how little I know about music.
Chorus is an open door for you.
No. The first one had tension,
that.
But it was.
Yes.
It was tension, but it was the wrong tension.
Really?
Right.
It's the wrong kind of tension. And it's right. You know, and it's right. It was sad. Because they were taking the idea. Because what's Bernstein's view of creativity, which we'll come to in a minute. I'm actually going to show you a video of Bernstein in a minute. You know, okay. But But the second one was our performance, and it was at the proper tuning of C256.
Which is also another class.
Which is also another whole discussion we can have, and I recommend everybody going to our paradigm show of this week of last week of Megan Beats, our collaborator on this. Because the question of tuning, what is your tuning? You're really tuning the mind. If you raise the pitch above the proper pitch, you're destroying the ideas. You're destroying. That's why the classical music isn't known today. What passes as classical isn't classical. Let's just have very short the opening of both of those once again. Play the Bernstein one first, and then I'll do the other. And then I want to go to the clip of Bernstein. And you'll see. Yeah. See, it's too flat. It's too it's too homogeneous. So if this is diamonds. So try to push the rock up. Okay. And it's not just that the tempo was faster in the second one, the one we did. It was the intention behind that to convey a different conception of man. It's a different tension. Hopefully it's taking your mind to a higher place. Quartet and find other put your mind through those paces. You know, it's you'll learn a lot. So it's, I know it's also hard just on one short clip to get it all, but given the time factor, I want to now play this Bernstein, and I'm using him as sort of synonymous for the whole turn of the century operation. I could go through a lot of stuff, Dave. You've seen all this, but we for the moment, and for most people, they would think, you know, LaRouche raises Leibniz all the time. He raises Kuza all the time. You know, these are not academic ideas. These are the founding of what it is to be human. And Leibniz played a very special role because, you know, picking up on the work from Kuza and Kapler, he really took this human mind, identity, soul, the question of the future very far. And remember, our constitution is based, as you know, on the principles of what Leibniz developed: life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, what is happiness? Is happiness, you know, going out and going shopping? I don't know. Is happiness? blowing, I don't know, bubbles or something? I don't know. But no, happiness is a very specific idea. And Leibniz also had another expression for it. It was called optimism, the best of all possible worlds. And his idea, which is very much, you know, the real identity principle because he was fighting in a period against this British Empire. That's why they couldn't wait till Leibniz died to bury him. And Leibniz knew that the idea of man as a creator, living in a universe which you never can know the whole gambit, but man's mind can always create new and better developments. And that's why we're intuned in a very specific way. And Leibniz was very much opposed by Voltaire, who wrote a piece attacking Leibniz called Candide. I don't know if some of you are familiar with that. And Leonard Bernstein composed an operatic or something. I don't know what you call it, but on Candide. It's called Candide. And in 1980s, he did a performance of it in London. And he decided he had to talk to the audience about why he composed Candide. And I'll let you be the judge. Okay, Wes.
Dear friends, I hear you thinking, here comes the old professor to lecture us again. But I promise to be brief and only by way of introduction. The reason I feel I should say a few words, if you pardon my croaky voice, I too have the English disease, like so many of you, the royal flu. The reason I feel I ought to say something is that for more than 30 years, 35 years to be exact, people have asked me, why Candide? Whither and whence Candide? But I thought I might answer a bit more clearly by speaking not only as the composer of this work, but as an everyday observer of history, like anyone here. But particularly of that period of history known as the Age of Enlightenment, roughly the 18th century. And that was the century in which Voltaire lived, wrote, and had extraordinary influence. His masterpiece was a tough, skinny little novella called Candide, which inspired the playwright Lillian Hellman and me to have a bash at it musically. Voltaire's book was actually entitled Candide or Optimism, it being a viciously satirical attack on a prevalent philosophical system known as optimism, which was based on the rather indigestible writings of a certain Gottfried Wilhelm von Leibniz and popularized by our own beloved Alexander Pope. For example, in this great line from his essay on man, one truth is clear, whatever is right. Now, according to Leibniz, whose ideas Pope was lyricizing, if we believe in a creator, then he must be a good creator, and the greatest of all possible creators, and therefore could have created only the best of all possible worlds. In other words, everything that is right. Granted that in this world the innocent are mindlessly slaughtered and that crime mostly goes unpunished, but there is disease and death and poverty. But if we could only see the whole picture, the divine universal plan, then we would understand that whatever happens is for the best. Thus spake Leibniz. Naturally, Voltaire found this idea absurd every day of his life. But particularly on that day in 1755, when all of Lisbon, Portugal, exploded in an earthquake. and uncountable numbers of people were drowned, crushed, buried alive, exterminated. Now, if Leibniz was right, said Voltaire, then God is just playfully spraying his flit gun and down go a million mosquitoes at random, haphazardly. Well, the Lisbon disaster was the last straw for Voltaire and provoked him to write Candide, in which he lashed out against all established authority, royal, military, or mercantile, but most of all at the power of the church, which actually was burning heretics at the time, burning them alive to prevent earthquakes. In other words, says Voltaire, sectarian religion is always an incitement to conflict, and optimism as a strict belief therefore breeds complacency, induces lethargy, inhibits the human power to change, to progress, to rise against injustice, or to create anything that might contribute to a genuinely better world. During my incredibly extensive researches for this lecture, which you are now suffering, I came across the following quite succinct summing up of the whole Voltaire-isme. Quote, Voltaire was acting as an eclectic who had synthesized the ideas of the Stoics, the Epicureans, the skeptics. Oh, the hell with it. Let's play the overture.
And I, you know, this idea, the tack on creativity and optimism, is this any different than what just happened with the British and Schnellenhuber in the new encyclical, where there's an attack on one of the sections on what Lynn and we have done, the Promethean man, and it says right in the new encyclical, often was handed on was a Promethean vision of a mastery over the world, which gave the impression that the protection of nature was something that only the faint-hearted cared about, instead of dominion over the universe, should be understood more properly in the sense of responsible stewardship. So this is one continuous, and this is what we have to get at in the changing of the culture. Now I'm just gonna wrap it up with one more last example. I want the quote up next. Yeah, the quote is, because next I'm gonna take you to Stravinsky. Now I know a lot of people love Stravinsky. He's very popular throughout, since he wrote The Firebird and Petrushka and The Rite of Spring in 1910. Think about it, Brahms dies in 1897. By 1900, Stravinsky becomes one of the great movers and shakers and definers of music. He had a lot of people behind him. He wasn't alone, but that's a whole other subject right now. But Stravinsky was not an accident. Neither was, you know, Bernstein an accident. Neither was the attack had to be on the human mind and soul. And I have up here a quote from Stravinsky's autobiography. And think about what's consistent in all the attacks by the British Empire through their satanic imps on the nature of man. And think about what Lynn has written, Mr. Rusch has put on the table, on what is the real creative genius of man, what Kuza put on the table, what Leibniz put on the table, that, you know, Kepler put on the table, that all, that Bach, Mozart, Schumann, forgive me if I left out a few, you know, because, which is what is under attack. And it is this question of living in the future. Living in the future of the human species immortality through generations. Going to higher orders of energy flux density, higher orders of technology, science, and culture that emits that in a society that's sane. And I guarantee you, if this coup had not happened at the turn of the century, we would not have children going into shopping centers, into churches, you know, shooting masses of people. You'd have a totally different generations of people who are related to each other. And that's what we're putting together with the, with this new just economic order. This is the fruits of the work of Lynn and Helga over the 40 years to create an institution that didn't create, was not there before, based on these principles. And that's what every serious musical composition does. It creates something that is never created before, but it's based on principle. And if that's not understood, which it's not today, you know, and I, me and I can both tell you, because we went through the horrors of music schools and conservatories. Mm-hmm. And this is not the training you get. You get the training of the equivalent of Euclid in music and works. So this is a quote from Stravinsky's autobiography. I live neither in the past nor in the future. I am in the present. I cannot know what tomorrow will bring forth. I can only know what the truth is for me today. That is what I am called upon to serve, and I serve it in its lucidity. Now, put up the quote from Lynn. Now, this is from a discussion Lynn and LaRouche had with some of our associates recently. He said, the beauty is creativity, per se. It's also the measure of what creativity is. So you take any composition, it's a sacred business. If you really want to do it, you're attempting a sacred work. And it's a sense of man's immortality. Even people, when they die, if they live well, they can contribute to a memory of beauty. And that really is done these days.
Rarely
done, I'm sorry, done these days. Now we're in one of the greatest periods, the most emotional part of human history that ever existed. We exist on the brink of the threat of the immediate destruction of the human species by the forces that dominate mankind today. Where do you find the passion that will inform you to take the actions which will save mankind from the destruction which is being brought by mankind on himself, on society? That's music. That's art. It's the sense of immortality, that those people who have died did not die in vain. But what they had decided to do is to commit themselves to the future of mankind. And now I'm going to play you, because the question of passion, the question of emotions, the question of mind, soul, this is a one. This is truth. And now I'm going to play you Stravinsky's Lacrimosa. I'll tell you the good news, it's only 1 minute and 49 seconds.
All right, have it.
Okay.
Let's see.
Okay. And think of the Mozart. Amen. was from Stravinsky's Requiem that he wrote. It's a full Requiem. That's the Lacrimosa section. I don't think I have to say much about that. Mm-hmm. But think about what we've tolerated in accepting Stravinsky and the likes of him as, quote, musicians. One second, Eric. Yeah. And this is what we can restore. We can bring harmony and beauty back into this world right now if each one of us, whether you're in the room or you're listening, takes to heart what we have to do in these coming weeks and realize the paradigm we're creating with a new just economic order, with the BRICS, with Greece, you know, who are in dialogue with Lynn Hangel LaRouche, we can bring a real humanity about and finally create a real classical mind and soul again. So what I think is, rather than take questions now, is let Miwa, I can present what she's got, and then we want to leave a whole hour for questions. Hmm? So just hold, I think, hold the questions. We want them all. And I'm going to let Miwa Steger, my dear friend and collaborator, who is a great musician as well as a great organizer. That's great.
Well, that was an interesting note to be left on.
Yeah.
So let's just revisit the context in which we're gathered, because our organization is right in the middle of the fight for the soul for mankind. And if that seems to you to be extreme, I would think about what you know to be happening around the world. Because essentially, if we don't take this up, you can tell we can't exist in this direction much longer. We meaning our species, mankind. Something has to break. Something drastic is essentially going to have to occur. And just to take up from the end of what Mindy presented, this question of living in the future, that Mr. LaRouche based this organization on the knowability of the nature of the human mind, that we have access. There's dogs over there, we've got all kinds of animals around us. But the one species that has the knowable capability of transforming its own species is the human species. And at a time now where you have a complete launching of an attack through the British monarchy, through the encyclical, through the Pope, the Pope's not really the problem. I think more so Schellenhuber's the problem. I don't know if you've ever seen any pictures of him, but he's kind of even disturbing to look at. So the intent, huh?
There's a picture of him here.
Oh, don't stare at it too long. Yeah. But this question of the future, I'm going to go back to the examples that we heard, the Bernstein, the Lacrimosa, between the Bernstein and what we did. Albeit neither of them were perfect, none of us are perfect, but are we engaged in a process of perfection? Do you think that the founding fathers of our country, when they committed to creating a more perfect union, what do you think that means? What do you think that means for us today, less than 300 years later? What do you think it meant for them then? And what do you think it's going to mean 300, 400, 500 years from now? The question, the first Lacrimosa that was conducted by Bernstein is the epitome of what I understand to be really the problem today, which I've experienced. I'm sure Mindy's experienced it. All of you have experienced it to some extent, is the absolute indulgence in the self. Self-indulgence, self-absorbed in the moment. Each and every tone that was produced was relishing in the moment. The second one wasn't just faster. I actually appreciated Chaitanya and Carol's comments, especially the one on the fact that there's a certain optimism to it. Because the Requiem, when people think of Requiem, they think of dead, right? Gone. No longer here. Stopped. You have to, our culture says you sort of have to indulge in this emotion to show how much you appreciated the person that came before. And that, what we were able to propel through the second performance is a tapping into the intention of Mozart. We're not, nobody's claiming to know one absolute truth. Because I think what we all have to confront is culture is what we create. We create our culture. We're not just subjects of a culture. Now, if you're going to create a culture, what do you have to know? What is the subject of music? What do you think the subject of culture and art is? Does anybody have an answer to that? You think it's your current emotional state? Your next emotional state? The previous one? Does it have anything to do with emotions? So this question of optimism is very interesting, especially with what Leibniz brings up. Because Leibniz, our clause, what the Republic of the United States was built upon as a foundation, as a conceptual foundation, was this question of optimism. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Happiness may mean acquiring, to some it may mean acquiring as many pleasures as humanly possible. That's certainly what we're confronting today. That's partly why we can't get people outside of themselves and their own individual circumstances and think about the question of universal history. Where do you come from? What process do you come from? What kind of process were you born into? And the critics of life, such as Voltaire, which wrote this Candide, which Bernstein so vehemently advocates. I mean, he was actually frothing at the mouth. He's so angry at Leibniz for being optimistic, for even saying that there is a God. Okay, I mean, he's a conductor conducting what you would understand as God's music, which is a reflection of the harmonies of the planets. We can get into that. That's something that our dear friend Megan Beads has taken up on the question of harmony. But people, even my own sister-in-law argues, well, there's so much suffering in today's world. How could there be a God? To assume that if there were a God, that everything would be quote-unquote perfect. There would be no suffering. There would be no paradoxes. There would be no challenges. But part of the conception from Leibniz is that the role, our continual role as a species in recreating itself, in recreating its identity, is to transform our species, inherently to confront these challenges and have a sense of optimism. Optimism is not a feeling, it's not an emotional state. It's the question of optimal, optimizing the potential that we, the divine potential that we were all born with. But do you live in a society, and this is the role of culture, this is why we've waged a war, essentially, against these individuals that claim that there is no God, that there is no future, we only live in the now. We're waging that war because the disintegration of our culture, the degradation, the fact that we can even turn our backs on farmers and treat them as criminals when they grow your food. They plant the crops that grow your food. So people like Governor Brown can go hang out with his friends like Obama and say that they've achieved essentially what Satan wants them to achieve, which is depopulation. That's really the foundation of the war. And the cultural question is what gives man a sense of passion, a sense of courage with beauty, because your soul, in participating in beautiful ideas, in participating in beautiful concepts in the hands of people like Bach and Mozart and Beethoven. Others. Hopefully, I think there should be somebody after Brahms. That's why we're doing this. Mm-hmm. Because since 1897, it's now 2015, we haven't had a qualitative breakthrough. We could play you all kinds of music from the 20th century composers. I'd rather not. I'd rather allow you to go to YouTube, the Bible of all Bibles. There you can find anything you want. But the we are what in one hypothesis that I have, it actually at least, and I think is knowable, because this is essentially the core of the attack, is that the nature of the human mind is not knowable. You can't know it. You can only have a certain opinion about it. You can only deduce it into some type of explanation. But how do you know truth? Are you seeking for an absolute truth? Some deducted mathematical formula of a proof to say, oh, that's my proof. That's what I'm going to carry with me. But it's an inner strength of your soul. This is something that you're born with. And the quality of the culture that's created from generation after generation cultivates the strength and the resilience of that, the beauty that actually exists within you, a certain divine spirit. Because we're going to confront problems in society. How else do we get better? We're going to confront shortages in water. If people are going to continue to be born, which we like, then we have to change accordingly. We have to transform ourselves accordingly. Why do we accept the idea that the pie is just going to stay the same size? And if the population continues to grow, well, we've got to figure out how to keep our size down. That's a direct attack on what Leibniz brings up and what Mr. LaRouche has built this organization to do. And I can attest to the fact that it is a brawl. And it's going to be the qualitative few. It's actually somewhat of an honor not to have this room filled with 4,000 or 5,000 people that have a sense of mediocrity, but actually a qualitative few. Abraham Lincoln was one person. Joan of Arc was one person. But the strength and resilience of their spirit and their soul to commit to the future, shaping of the generation of the future of mankind, is exactly what we're involved in. So on that, just to give you a sense, I think Michael brought up Schiller at the beginning. And, you know, you see the problems today. When we talk to people, they do live in the now. The culture has brainwashed people to live in the immediate, the 3-minute song, the whatever commercial. You're just going second by second. That was definitely the core of the attack, at least on the culture. Schiller had a very different conception of universal history. And he even wrote an entire essay on it. And I'm just going to take a small part of it to give you a sense, because he discusses this in the context of the question of human immortality, that is actually the idealistic humanity that we have access to. Each and every one of us. An important means to accomplish this, meaning immortality, is the study of universal history. Because only the person who knows how to cherish how much all the battles, personal sacrifices, and spending of lives by all generations that have come before were necessary to secure our own existence and to create all the wealth we possess today. Only such a person will experience a noble yearning to contribute to passing these received treasures, enriched and increased, onward to posterity, and thereby firmly linking our fleeting existence to the eternal chain of all peoples and all times. Because many times people say, well, that was in the past. George Washington, Gouverneur Morris, Alexander Hamilton, there was it's a concept of zeitgeist, the spirit of the times, right? We live in the now. This is how we translate it. But we are a continuing process of the development of mankind, whether we take up that identity or not. And our own species transforms by the decision from, like I said, a qualitative few to take up that fight, such as Mr. LaRouche. So essentially two of the people that Mindy brought up that do exist in the 20th century, at least, well, three, we'll put Lyndon LaRouche. He's always there. He's there every Thursday for you, in case you wanted to know, on a call, on a phone. He's a phone call away. But Fort Vangler and Brineen are not. And the essential role of these individuals and the question of culture is crucial. Even if you haven't worked on a piece of music, maybe you've never sung a song, perhaps you've never read a piece of poetry, we are responsible. I mean, it's not just a culture of your own likes or dislikes. It is a human culture. The fact that this is what transforms your capability and your spirit to confront problems and overcome them. Fort Vangler was one of the first, well, he was inherited the conductorship of the Berlin Philharmonic, I think around 1923. He made knowable the process involved in music that really I don't think anybody ever has been able to, because that's the question. People say, well, we can't really read music. What's your metric to understand what music is true? What's your metric to understand what you're hearing is true? It obviously doesn't have words. In Mindy's examples, don't have the words of the Lacrimosa. But the music of, well, not sounds, but actual just music is the actual subject here. And it's the essence of the creative process. Because when you look at something like a score, what do you see? You see footprints. You see footprints from a former creative soul that existed. How do you interpret it? What's your role? What's your responsibility as a person that's going to take this on as a mission? Do you impose a sense of your opinion? Do you have to follow what your interpretation is? Fort Vangler goes through it very clearly in one of his essays called Principles of Interpretation. And he distinguishes between, here it is. Essentially between a literal performance and a creative performance. Now, what do you think he means by literal? Anybody?
Performing the notes.
Right. Dale.
Going through the motions.
Going through the motions. Okay. Tony?
I think what we heard, the first performance of the Lacrimosa, where he took slow to the extreme.
Slow. Yeah, I don't even remember how that movement is marked. But these are all good points, because you do have footprints. Wes, can you put up the first, I think it's the first link. Okay. So this is what you have. These are the footprints of Beethoven. There are a few markings. There are some people that have access to the original manuscripts. These are obviously copies. But I think in certain copies, in some editions, the dynamic markings are true. But when you see something like a double pianissimo, which means extremely soft or very soft, or a forte, which means loud, well, how do you know how loud it should be? How do you know how soft the double pianissimo is? And, you know, the fact that it can't really give you a clue as to the intensity of the color or the intensity of the forte, the intensity of the double pianissimo. So this is essentially your guide. And in one sense, what Furtwängler goes through with the literal interpretation, where you have somewhat of a dogmatic approach to the music, and anybody that veers from that specific pianissimo or forte should be shot. Right? And they get extremely, formal on that basis. But then you have the creative presentation, on the other hand. It's a certain indulgence. And whatever you say, Beethoven's dead, it's up to me now. It's up to what I say. And in terms of what, and I'll bring this up in a bit, based on Breinin and Breinin's relationship to Mr. LaRouche on the question of music. But this is exactly the point that you have with the creative presentation. You have people that are saying, well, we're totally in opposition to the past. Just like a lot of Americans today, a lot of world citizens. Whatever came before me, I'm here now, and we're essentially going to live in the moment. But rather than thinking of yourself and somebody that's bequeathed with something like this, which is part of a late Beethoven string quartet. And if you know anything about Beethoven, the latter part of his life is extraordinary. And people can discuss, we can discuss that at some point. I don't want to distract or detract from originally what we're doing. But somebody that's bequeathed with something like this should think of themselves as a certain natural heir to these ideas. And essentially what you're going to do in your mission to fulfill a just representation of these ideas is to consummate the past that has come up until this point and give a sense of gift to the future for people to know this is not, it's not one unified explanation. It's not an absolute truth. What makes a composition or a performance effective from beginning to end? That's the most challenging question for a musician. Because what are they ultimately submitting themselves to? And so if you keep the two of these questions in your mind, this literal interpretation where you follow the score, you follow every it's like a map, right? It's like a predicated map. And you can follow it pretty literally, and maybe you hear something generally good. But does it move your soul? Does it transform your soul? What Michael brought up at the beginning on the question of, I think it was you at the beginning, or somebody was saying, the Schiller's concept of leaving the theater a better human being, that the role of this culture is to instill in you a sense of optimism, a sense that a potential can be fulfilled. It's not hopeless. It's not the end of the world. Obama's not going to be in there for another 17 months. There's nothing we can do. We might as well just sit back and wait. And that's the crime. That's the actual crime that's been fulfilled in terms of the attack on the culture, like Mindy said, especially since the 1960s and the assassinations of John F. Kennedy, Bobby, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X. That was a terrifying period of transformation in this country. And we haven't recovered. We're in the process of recovering. And actually, I would even say we're in a better situation now, ironically, because of the BRICS, because of what's occurring around the world. The fact that the BRICS nations have consolidated these ideas, consolidated and discovered the essence of Leibniz, the essence of Furtwängler even, and Breinin and Lyndon LaRouche, because they're moving forward. They're actually shaping a very future-oriented future with other nations. Our only ally right now, I think, is Canada. So maybe, huh? Maybe that's not true, but it's very small. So what I wanted to do is play a clip. Did you, were you able to? Okay. The second one. The second link. I don't want you, I don't want it shown.
Okay.
That's not the second one. So what I want to play for you is an excerpt of Beethoven's string quartet, Opus 132. And I think part of the fun here is going to be that you'll have to judge for yourself again. If you didn't think that first one was fun, then this will be even more fun, hopefully. Oh, we like it. I mean, if people speak with convictions, that's the way. You don't know either way. It's definitely encouraged. There's no judgment. And the main point is, are we capable of changing? That's the main point. We don't live in a static universe. How do I do this? I'm going to play. Why don't you play? Thank you. Did people realize they were different? You notice a difference? Right, exactly what Mindy said at the beginning. You have the same notes. You have the same footprints. But yet all three of them are almost completely different. Now, the difficulty of a string quartet, and then the difficulty of what the Requiem, is that you're dealing with numerous individuals who shouldn't be fighting over who gets the first note or who gets more say or more strength. I will play them again. I wanted to just give you an introduction into that and also introduce you to a great figure named Brineen, who is an absolute, I would consider, an absolute authority and made a complete breakthrough, just as Furtwängler, on the nature of music. And they made what, to most musicians and people in society, made these ideas accessible. Because what's wrong with the oligarchy? The oligarchy wants us to be stupid. They don't want these ideas to be accessible to the common man. And that's the crime. The crime of oligarchism is that these ideas are only for a selective few, the selected elite. And that brings another purpose to the question of tuning. But that is also another part of our presentation down the line. So Brineen, has anybody heard of the Amadeus String Quartet in terms of our guests? Okay, this is one of the greatest string quartets ever. It still is. I haven't heard anybody that surpassed them in quality as a unified grouping. Brineen had a special relationship with Mr. LaRouche on the question of a unity of music, and they had several discussions. But I'm just going to take the Amadeus String Quartet up now because these are case studies that are well worth us taking up, particularly because this is, we're gonna be able to discover a knowability for the purposes of battling this sick culture. And Bryneen, if you really think about it, we're playing singular presentations or singular performances. Is that to say that one performance was the best, was the most perfect, is the end all be all? No, absolutely not. The idea, the commitment of the Amadei, but there is a certain consistency of identity among the members of the Amadeus String Quartet, led by Bryneen, that was able to time and time again effectively communicate the intentions of the composer. And it's, like I said, it's never an absolute. There can be numerous effective presentations and performances, but does it hang together as a unity? Because that is the ultimate challenge when one's presented with a piece of music in our chorus, when we're presented with a new piece or something that we've worked on, like the Requiem, or when somebody looks at a poem, if you've read a poem or looked at a work of art, but I'll just take the music and the poem as the two most relevant examples, is the question of the future has to come through a unified intention in you. It's a subjective, emotional decision. So the how is it that the Amadei, is it any good performances? Is it really just pure luck? Did they all wake up on the right side of the bed and drink, you know, whatever they needed to drink? I know a performer that had to drink 11 shots of espresso before every performance. She's a pianist. Martha Argerich. She's still around. She's flailing around. So these are certain things, right? That's not the substance of what we're getting at. Because the substance, it's a constant fight. As is, it's a constant fight for all of us as organizers, as people that are trying to talk to other people about these ideas, find themselves, you know, shoving themselves up against a wall because they feel like nobody's listening. And the ultimate objective is to fight for a quality of unity. This past Monday, Mr. LaRouche had a discussion with the policy committee on the question of harmony. Because harmony isn't just about music. The BRICS represents a quality of harmony in the universe. Because what they're unifying, the ultimate intention with which they're unified is a human spirit that's above and beyond all of their unique contributions, but is an elevated sense of humanity. And that's the challenge even in the microcosm of the quartet, and the microcosm of organizing your friends and family around the fact that, look, Obama is not your Lord and Savior. We have a Lord, we have a God, and it's very dissonant with what we know to be true. So let me just tell you the truth, okay? Because it does exist, you can tell. You have a metric for knowing how it exists. So that is the ultimate challenge for these quartets and people that are gonna engage in this level of ideas. And at this point, I would appeal to people that we must. Even if we've never had training, if you've never read poetry, if you've never recited poetry, if you've never worked on a song, it's not really for the betterment of yourself, but it's the capability of developing an insight into what beauty is. Because I had a certain privilege to work with Mr. LaRouche under sort of his tutelage in a quartet setting. And one very provocative comment that he made, which is not what people are presented with in general. When you go to a symphony, people relish in the fact that they received beautiful tones, beautiful sounds. And that's not the real spirit, I would say. The objective of a performance is not to create and generate beautiful sounds. Sounds a little bit strange, right? But it's actually a somewhat triangulated effect for the musicians to be able to communicate a quality of insight into beauty that they've discovered. Mm-hmm. So if you think about it, that's the ultimate challenge. It's not a direct relationship back and forth between you and the audience and the composer, but it's an elevated quality that drives. It's an organic force that drives the composition forward. In a sense, you get taken over by a quality of passion because you're participating in an unfolding of the future of mankind. If you don't think from that standpoint when participating in and working on these ideas, then it's a challenge to continue to do so because these ideas are sacred. When you listen to them, when you experience a Beethoven string quartet in terms of the highest quality and you're able to sit and concentrate, I definitely encourage people to sit and listen to one in full. In full meaning the whole four movements or however many movements there are. But the quality of impact that it has on you is, it's a certain simultaneity of eternity, okay? It's the ultimate experience, I guess you could call it. So what I wanted to do, I don't know if people have comments about the three different, I know it probably went by a bit quickly, but we're going to listen to the three again. And there is, we're not searching for a question of right or wrong, but just be open to what you think. Even if you've never heard these compositions before, have a sense of confidence that you actually are able to hear a certain rightness. That's actually true. So can we get the first one?
Thank you.
Comments, because I want to get some comments on some on the three examples that were played, and then we'll go back and respond to it.
Okay.
Is that okay? Because I want to make sure that what's resonated, hopefully it's still resonating in people's minds, the three different performances.
Right. It's totally different highways I'm thinking on, you know, and I understand what you're trying to do. It's good. It really is. This is how I like this. I said on my YouTube, I have so many YouTube songs on there, but you can knowledge of this is far beyond mine. Right? And, but I wasn't, you know, I just, this is something pertaining to 17 months.
Sure.
Which,
we'll take it up.
And it's really not realistic, you know, from the view of a war. I could be a warrior would not even take that, you know, and having surrender mean that I would just think I put together with the lays out what would happen.
Sure.
And
we'll take it up. We'll definitely take it up. Ed.
Number two.
We've got votes.
And
we're casting votes.
Again?
No, I said we're casting votes.
No, the reason I like number two, the second one, there were two things that I noticed about the music. Number one, the flow of it was seamless.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I did not hear any, the other two, I heard slight moments of what I thought was a dissonant sound.
Okay.
Just for a very short time.
Okay.
When I hear that, I didn't hear that in the second.
Okay.
It was seamless.
Smooth.
Absolutely flowed through the entire piece of music, and I heard nothing that raised any kind of
flag.
Bad thing.
Okay. Sarah?
That's why I didn't like the second one.
Conflict of opinions here. Carol?
The whole thing about playing music from a score is that you have your notes, but the individual is free to arrange them however they want to create the feeling that they want. And you were talking about feelings before. Is it their feeling now, or is it the feeling they want to convey? It's both.
Right.
They write from the feeling they have now and hoping they can convey that feeling or another higher feeling in the person listening to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it has to do with the, like you said before, the 4Ks and the pianissimos and how they're applied. And like I said again, their interpretation of, well, what's too soft? What's too loud?
Right.
What does one F mean? What does two P's mean?
Right.
The crescendos and the decrescendos.
Right.
They all play together. And the second one was a little faster than the first one. And I don't know about anybody else, but I thought the third one, the notes were the same, but in some places it was played an octave lower. Did you pick up on that?
They didn't change the range.
Oh, okay.
It was probably an effect of how it unfolded, which made you
think
it was lower.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought number three was seemed higher for whatever reason.
Higher in pitch?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Maybe the frequencies or something. That's what I heard.
Sure. I have, yes.
Did you play those in the same order that Mindy?
Absolutely. Did? I am not trying to mess with you.
Okay. It seemed that way, but that it was the same order.
Yes.
But when I heard Mindy play them about an hour ago, I remember that the second one stood out for me. It just seemed to radiate more optimism.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you played them, by that time they were all starting to sound alike.
Mm.
No,
they're different pieces. Bob.
Yeah. Well, I want to add something, explain something. The Bernstein, you know, I thought had a lot of tension. Mindy said it's the wrong kind of tension. Mm-hmm. Now, when I was listening to these three things, the first one I thought had a lot more tension. Now, I'm beginning to think maybe I got the wrong concept of tension.
No.
Because, like, you know what the first one reminded me of?
What?
And I don't know. When I was younger, 30 years ago,
yeah.
I used to listen to a lot of quartets by the Bush Quartet.
Uh-huh.
I really loved them.
Yeah.
Because the tension, the voices, the dissonance, I thought they were great. Now, I've had people tell me over the years that there are problems with them. I never understood why. But the first one sounded like the Bush Quartet, the way they played. Now, I'm suspecting that was not the Amadeus Quartet. So I don't know, you know. But this is, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I know what you're saying. I like it. I definitely appreciate it. It's this struggle really what we're struggling with together is a quest for truth.
Yeah.
That's what we're actually socially experiencing. And that's profound. This is how we're going to win the battle over evil. And I'm not sure if I'm ready to disclose.
Well, I'll say one thing.
Okay. Other people.
But I listened to the first recording a lot. And so when I heard it this time, I just kind of like took it for granted. And the second one, I was like, oh, yeah, there's problems here. The third one, I was like, oh, well, this is kind of interesting. You know, so it's a little different. But then listening to them again, I paid more attention to the first one. And it's just so much better. It just, it really just drives all the way through.
Right.
And kind of forces, it just forces a certain engagement. You can hear it among them. You're forced to participate unless you've been brainwashed by listening to it too much.
Yeah. And then you tune out, but then you re-engage yourself.
Yeah, so I actually liked listening to the three and then again because I heard the first one a lot better.
Right, yeah. I wasn't going to stop. Yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say that it sounded like the first one, there was a, there were voices knew what they were saying more, that it was more distinct, that even though there was, and they were saying different things,
mm-hmm.
in the dialogue, that it was more, you know, clear what each one was saying, or that each one was part of the dialogue, that the second and third one started to meld together a little bit.
Okay.
Or the message became more of a, or the voices became more of them trying to be like the other as opposed to be like themselves.
Like a, yeah, sort of reminds me of a chorus that tries to temper out their sound.
Yeah.
Right. Somebody else had, Al.
Yeah, I wanted to say, as what I was thinking about, which isn't totally resolved in my mind,
mm-hmm.
is, you know, there's there's sort of two parts to what you played. There's the opening part with the sort of sustained notes.
Yes.
And then there's the part that goes, da 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 da.
Right.
Now, in the third version, one of the voices, maybe it was the viola or the other violin, I don't know, but one of the voices within that drawn out tension,
yeah,
was actually playing the second part.
Mm.
You could hear it in the third version,
mm-hmm.
and you couldn't hear it in the first and second.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And at first I was like, oh, this is interesting, right? They're giving you hints for the future.
Right.
But then I thought about it more, and I'm like, well, I don't know if I actually like this or not, because maybe you don't want to literally express what is to come and just sort of know that it's there.
Right.
Anyways, I noticed that in the third version both times when you listen to it, that you could hear the next part. You could hear the next part within the first part. And maybe it was too literal, maybe it wasn't, I don't know. But.
That's interesting. These are very, very interesting insights. Ed, I think you raised your hand again.
A question I had, is it not one of the purposes of a string quartet to blend together?
Absolutely no.
No. They're playing their music seamlessly. I mean,
well,
they go from one step to another, but they all blend together as they go. Now,
I'm thinking about what you're saying.
I had a very brilliant teacher in my life when I was in the sixth grade, and I asked her what music is, and she said, "Those they are sounds that are pleasing to the ear." And that's what I go by. If I hear a sound that is pleasing to my ear, that's my song. And that may sound really simple,
no.
But I play a lot of music on the guitar and the bass at home, probably 3 or 4 hours a day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, all I would say is that you're young. There's always room to be confronted with what you think you know to be true.
Well,
from
experience,
and for it to be challenged, it's possible until the day you pass. That's possible for every single one of us, and that's what we have to be willing to embrace. Is this quality of always having the capability to change. Because that's what society depends upon. It depends upon our commitment to change and not to stay static and not to stay humdrum, you know, the pinnacle of our life, and then you retire, and then it just all goes downhill from there. And you're just waiting to get 6 foot under. This is what the spiritual subject with which we're dealing is on a much different level, which is actually why it's the core of the fight that we've waged, of our entire political movement. This is the core of the substance, which is the culture. And this is from Furtwängler, just to give you a sense, because I really appreciate all of the sentiments. But you have here, because Ed, what you brought up is not the role of the quartet to blend together. And this doesn't directly go after that, but it gives you a bit of an insight into what each performer or member of the quartet or musician confronts when they're presented with the score. How does it appear to its interpreter, the performer? In the first place, it is a printed source. It is not the performer's task to portray the pattern of his own spiritual life, but to follow it in minute detail, the course of a work long since complete, created by somebody else. He, the performer, has to work backwards, as it were, not forwards like the composer. Contrary to the direction in which life evolves, he has to move from the outside to the inside, not vice versa, like the composer. His path is not one of improvisation, that is, of natural growth, but one characterized by the painstaking assembly and arrangement of component parts. And whereas for the composer, these parts, as in any organic process, merge naturally into his vision of the work as a whole, which gives them their individual life and meaning, the performer, for his part, has to laboriously reconstruct such a vision for himself and of the separate parts at his disposal. So the implication here is that there is a scientific method to approaching these ideas.
I'm getting it backwards.
You're getting it backwards.
No, I'll play something and I'll say, that didn't sound right. So I'll play it again. That sounds better. And I keep working on it till it sounds like exactly like I want. And then I've got it. I go to something else. And that's not what these people are doing.
Not on a different level.
On a different
level. On a certain level.
Yeah.
But this is a bit of a transformed level than that. They're taking up a different question. Because I will say, in terms of the Amadeus String Quartet, you can take them as an institution, as sort of an icon of culture and society. That the core of what allows them to be effective, it's not like in the rehearsal process, it's perfect. The performances are an unfolding of a hypothesis. And in every moment, the unfolding of that hypothesis is driven by an intention. And the entire time, you're driven to unify everybody's intention. So you can never plan anything out. You never hear a performance the same way twice. It's not, you could have the same four people, and they could play the same music and have them play it twice in a row. It will not be the same. But what will determine the unfolding unity of each performance? That's the substance of what we're getting at. Because if in the case of the Amadeus String Quartet, the consistency of identity and emotion to be committed to that quality of identity, to actually submit themselves and their own personal wants and desires, and submit themselves to a higher purpose, is actually what we would like to achieve. And that's the standard, at least. And that's the quality of standard that we're reviving in the organization. So I think that's difficult, because for a performer, you have all kinds of emotional ups and downs. But is that going to affect you when you have a time to perform? Is that going to be able to affect you? You think it should? Somebody that has a performance like Friday, Saturday, Sunday, you see these people at the operas, or you see people that quartets that give concerts over the weekend. Your commitment obviously has to be outside of yourself for a higher purpose, and that role in music in society is the highest form of expression for human beings to be involved in. You could put a quartet in, in the Baltic states or in Africa or in Southeast Asia, and you would be able, it's a universal language that sees no race, that sees no, it sees no class, it sees nothing, but the unifying concept that you are human. That's why it's a universal language. And the soul's access to that the role of the performers and the role of the people that have the responsibility of these ideas is to give people access to that and not take it away from them. So with the three, I don't know if people want to hear it again, and we can continue the discussion. Does anybody else have comments on any of the three that they heard?
When you're listening to them, I would just suggest to people, because I also have listen to this movement a lot. And I often go to Beethoven all the time, because when you think of yourself taking responsibility for the population, which obviously has problems that we obviously need to develop, you run into a lot of things in yourself that you have to overcome. So in listening to these, I would suggest people to listen to them from the standpoint of who would you go to? Like which one would you actually go to help you through something that you're confronting within yourself? That's kind of how I think about it. Not which one did it, like, you know, which one sounded the best, the most seamless, the most homogenous, which one executed the piece technically the best, but who would you actually go to work through a profound problem? Mm-hmm. And I think that's a different way to think about it when you're listening to these, a different measure. Mm-hmm.
I have a question.
Oh, I forgot LA was a, oops.
LA can ask the question. They have.
Yeah, we have a question here.
Yeah, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. The first one that there was a sense of freedom. The second one was disconnect. The third, there seems to be some sort of sense of development, but there wasn't a sense of freedom that I got from the first. So that was
mm-hmm. Well, we're about to play it again.
Good.
For you to reaffirm your sense. But it's true, what Sarah's bringing up, this question of an authority as a certain guide that you would look to. Because the problems that we confront are somewhat universal as well. We have a commitment to the protection of the general welfare. That's what we were born into. Now, do we take that up as a mission? And what quality of standard do we look to give us the sense of resilience and confidence and courage to get through it?
Why don't you play them in order again? Thank you.
Challenge presented before us. Yeah, I'm sorry.
What I got from well,
could you speak up? I'm sorry.
The three music.
Yeah.
That I heard. The first one sounds more. It's more loud. But it's like a little rough. As you go on the second one and third one, it becomes more smoother, and it's a different instrument, and it's low. So it's more calm.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost like it's going backwards.
Mm-hmm.
From rough, we're going from rough to calm. And you're saying it's like linked. Eric told me that it was linked to like a
political. Oh, I was telling him real quietly here that the culture and the music is a link to the political war that we're
in. Absolutely.
This culture is so much of everything.
Right.
So when I heard, so when I said to myself that it was going backwards, it's like we in our area, we're going backwards as well, because the culture and what's going on in the world right now, we're going backwards.
Right.
So it's also what I hear from first to second, from third. What it's supposed to be is supposed to be the other way, from third to first. So it's kind of going backwards, like we are going backwards. So that's how I see it, in a way.
Okay. Eric?
I'd like to add what Vance said. I was going to reserve this for after you were off the three here and getting opinions on the three. But because of something that Vance said, I want to add to that. This last go around, I changed my mind.
Mm-hmm.
The first one appealed to me more this time.
Interesting.
I have no idea why, except that the first one, I was thinking future.
Yeah.
And The second one, I was just in the present, and the third one was in the past, just the past. And what he said about going backwards, what I've been thinking through this entire meeting, and what I want to share with you real briefly, Thomas, is that all through this meeting, I've been thinking about the reason that people are mixed up about their priorities, about their future,
right,
and stuck in where they are. And one of the reasons is, long ago, I came to realize that the pecking order of time is not past, present, and future. It's future, present, and past. Because an event was future before it was ever present and before it was ever past. And if you look at, you know, when a baby's born, when Abraham Lincoln was born, what was really important? The future of these children. And whatever Abraham Lincoln did was future before it was ever present, before it was ever past. And when I listened to Igor Stravinsky earlier, about an hour and a half ago here, I was thinking that I was stuck in nothing.
It's pretty accurate.
With what he said, it was like he was saying, I'm nothing.
Well, that's pretty much what he says, because he's in the present. Still.
I got a different interpretation on Stravinsky. Music has different, what they're trying to convey. Not everything is a string quartet. There's orchestral pieces, and they all have a different attitude into what they want to project.
Right.
And like the string quartet, I felt like in one of us, the violin was sort of the key of the movie star.
Which one?
I think it was the third one.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes the music, the vocality or the fluency of the music wasn't always even.
Right.
So you'd have a different result.
Good. Well, these are all extremely useful.
Yes.
And just to tie it back to really what the substance of the discussion is. Because, okay, you have people like Furtwängler or Leibniz or Lyndon LaRouche or Breinin, but we have to really confront within ourselves what we are going to be. On a subjective level, are we going to take up this quality of mission, not look to others? But this is the ultimate challenge, which is the emotional capability to respond and defend such beauty. Actually, you yourself having an unrelenting and uncompromising commitment to the beauty of these ideas. And it's not just beauty, it's a quality of truth. They're one and the same. If they're reflected from this standard, it is one and the same as a reflection. Because the onus is really on us as individuals. We're not part of an egalitarian society. We're not part of a communistic society. Within society, our contributions are essentially what we make. That's, you shape your life. You make the contributions to society. So that's just to put it back into context, because of course we can have all different kinds of opinions, and they're somewhat valid, only based on the fact, only if it's based on whether or not you're going to commit to a higher quality of truth. That's when it's useful. That's when a certain hypothesis or opinion is useful. So I can tell you the first quartet was the Amadeus String Quartet. The second was the Borodin String Quartet, also very famous. The third was the Alban Berg String Quartet. I forget the years. I mean, I think that the Borodin was in Central Europe, and then the Alban Berg is in, basically resides in the United States. I tried to get the Juilliard String Quartet. That would have been a lot of fun. But the difference that you hear in the first is a quality of, I think, like Eric said, the future, that it continues to pull you forward. That you're never indulging in a certain moment, right, or relishing in a moment. I have I mean, we could go through certain technical things, but I won't. There's just a that very beginning part where you have essentially the slow introduction and then the transformation to what the violin, you know, that cascade that comes down. Can you just play the first one?
This one?
Yeah. And then you can put the music up. Yeah, well, each unfolding moment is determined by a conception of the whole, which is what Furtwängler, which is essentially his mastery in being able to conduct at the level and quality that he had. You have the music? Oh, yeah. So we're just going to play just up to here. This is the Amadeus. If you hear all three of them just up to that point, I mean, look, it's all hinged upon, like I said, a unifying conception. It's not that we're taking these ideas apart, but you can get a sense of the effect. Can you go back to the score? A sense of the effectiveness by how it unfolded. And this is a moment of transformation in the composition, that the moments of transformation are extremely difficult, partly because in music school, they sort of pass them by as passing moments. They don't consider, it's just the object or the actual, it's the moment after the transformation that's the key. So a certain object's fixation, a momentary fixation. But Mr. LaRouche has always talked about the question of these crucial moments, which are transformative in nature, and that each and every single composition has these moments of singularity, which are able, when you're able to unfold it effectively, because every time the Amadeus Quartet did it, it was probably different.
Yeah, different.
It was different. They're not robots. They're not programmed robots. So it gets you to think on a deeper level of what the challenge is. What? Oh. So I forgot I left my train of thought.
What the deeper challenge is.
Yeah. On a subjective level. Because I can't emphasize enough that there's a certain responsibility on each of us to take up a full responsibility and not look to our neighbors, not look to our brothers or our sisters or our parents or our friends, but to take it up to the fullest level of standard. I don't have to play the other two, but if people want to listen to the other two, I can send you who they are. You can compare them back and forth and get a sense. But these are necessary to do, to listen, have a sense of judgment, have a sense of hypothesis, and also know that truth does exist, but it's not a question of absolute truth. It's not a definition in terms of the unfolding of one's life. It's what you're willing to identify with in terms of the unfolding of mankind and how you're going to shape that process. So I don't know if people have questions or something.
what are the criteria that determine how good a student quartet is? Consistency? Skill? What are the things that...
You could say consistency and identity.
Okay.
Not consistency as a group.
So the way they play things is consistent and they play it in an appropriate way. But not appropriate. There's no,
no, because the substance of what we're really dealing with is not in and of itself the quartet, but it's the nature and the knowability of the human mind.
Does creativity get in there?
Huh?
Does creativity get in there at all?
Well, that's the nature of the human mind. But the knowability, that it's not some ethereal thing that exists, but that there is a knowability to it. But the metric of that knowability was actually, you were already born with it, in a sense.
Okay.
And through the destruction of the culture, that's why the empire is so dangerous, partly, well, they're not really that dangerous anymore.
Mm.
But the crime is that people, that access to their own metric of truth was basically, what do you call it, pummeled out of them by being inundated with, one, repetitive sounds,
yeah,
higher tunings, and they've essentially been soul washed or brainwashed.
I'll throw a term at you. Thinking outside the box.
Uh-huh.
Does that come into this?
Yes.
All right.
It does. You got it. Gerald.
I just want to say one thing. Thinking outside the box, remind me. We have a video on the Amadeus Quartet that being interviewed by BBC, and they talk about how they started, how they got going originally. And they were thinking outside the fence. They were in a prison camp in World War II. They were Jewish people.
I think I heard that.
Yeah. So here they are in the middle of the war. They get rounded up, and, you know, because they're from Washington. From, so they were considered part of the enemy, even though they were Jewish. They get rounded up by British. So.
Oh yeah, there's links to. Oh, sorry.
I was going to say, I think in understanding the depth of what you hear when you heard the first one, it's important to actually know who the people are and what where they came from. So if you want to say something.
Yeah. No. Mindy. Well, just quickly to address it because we're almost running out of time.
Yeah.
And I do want to go back and take up Brian's question in a certain way, which is related to the musical question. Is that, yeah, I mean, the idea of what music was to Norbert Reinemann was the very soul of the creative process. And the quartet did come together. Well, actually, it was a trio first, mm-hmm, because the cellist was, he's the only person in the quartet that was not in the internment camps during World War II. He later met the three of the what became the quartet after the war. But it's this passion question, what Miwa was just bringing up about passion and creativity being united. There's a mission to what that quartet does. Mm-hmm. They're not just interested in making money. They're not interested in just going out and performing. I believe for them, it's not about performing. It's about a mission to recreate the soul of mankind back to a real standard of what it is to be human. And that's why when Norbert met Lynn, Norbert met us on a deployment,
mm-hmm,
at our literature table,
mm,
where he came up and we were getting out a leaf that I think was on the tune or some concert we were doing. I can't remember.
It was a concert.
Concert we were doing. And he took the leaflet and read it, and we got in touch with him. And he says Lynn LaRouche is the greatest musician that he's ever met. Because of, and Lynn and he had lots of discussions on this question of tuning, on this question. And, you know, to Norbert's credit, when Mr. LaRouche was put in prison, or was right before the imprisonment, when he was being sent to prison, the sentence had come down, Norbert gave a concert in Washington, D.C. in Constitution Hall for Lyndon LaRouche, right in Washington, D.C., in the heart of the beast. And he spoke some very beautiful words about Lynn before he went and did the concert, and did it at the lower tuning. So that's, you know, what you see in the Amadeus Quartet is this kind of leadership, which is willing to go outside of the box, literally, in a principled way to stand with Mr. LaRouche against the whole British Empire forcing through the, you know, people into conformity. And just to take up what Brian brought up before, look, the question is process. It's like it is in music. You know, you're not going from moment to moment to moment if you're really inside of the process of the, of what is truly in the mind of a great composer, you know, what is presented before us in the shadows of the score. He's unfolding a process. Time is not clock time. Time doesn't go, you know, here, tick-tock, tick-tock, tick-tock. Time actually operates from the future. And the future is governing you in unfolding a process of what you have to do at any given moment. So when Lynn says 17 months in shaping a presidency, he's looking at time not as clock time. But he also, and he knows that in order to get there, you're going to have to do what we have to do in the next few weeks in finishing off the satanic British Empire, getting Glass-Steagall through, and getting Obama out. But it's a unity. It's just like in a great, like what Meemaw was just going through, in a great, either whether you're the performer or whether you're the composer or the conductor, you have to have this unified goal. Where do you want to move society? Where do you want to take society? And Beethoven made it very clear. I mean, I think the story goes that at one point in his life, you know, when he composed these late quartets, I think it was, in fact, the first violinist at the time who said, this is very, very difficult. This is what you just written in this, like this Opus 132. This is really challenging. This is difficult. And Beethoven says, well, I wrote it for the future.
Wow.
So, you know, this is why Mozart, I just wanted to end with this, you know, just to go back for a minute to this Voltaire versus Leibniz question. The real nature of the fight culture was not seen as something you do in your bedroom or in just even a concert hall just for your private entertainment. When Voltaire died, Mozart was in Paris at the time. And he wrote a letter to his father. And he made it very clear, I'll summarize because I can't find the letter right now, to his father, where he said, you know, the dog is dead. He's pegged out the way he was all his life. And he was talking about the death of Voltaire.
Wow.
So this was real warfare, and we're engaged in that now. So I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
We can take a few more minutes.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so some more questions? Go ahead.
Yes, I have a question. Voltaire apparently was very much regarded by Mozart.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that. I'm glad you told me to mention that because I wasn't really sure. I always thought that Voltaire was more or less a relativist.
Mozart was against Voltaire.
Oh, okay.
Here's a quote. I found the quote. This is in a letter to his father on July 3rd, 1778 from Paris. Now I have a piece of news for you, which you may have already heard, namely that godless arch rascal Voltaire has pegged out like a dog, like a beast. That is his reward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Voltaire and Rousseau, I never saw too much difference.
Yeah, right. Right, that's right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, any other questions there? Brian? Okay, Brian, go ahead.
This pertains to the 17-month period. Exactly 17, go on. I'm thinking much of said today about further about this since I spoke earlier. was that music may have been used to form our culture to weaken us over the long term. But right now, Molotov is the term of tanks and what with Russia and China, the U.S. troops or NATO, obviously not. Huh. And of course, the war, of course, occurred this summer. The U.S.
Yeah.
NATO around Russia, around China, threatening Putin. They came up the villain, really well, going to the White House. And so, and the Queen, it's come to the Queen of England for the BRICS Bank. That's all about time with BRICS, and you know, as you well know, BRICS breaking the back, financial back of the Rothschild to the Bank of England.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, Russia already stated way before that that it would not participate in the New World Order. So, but here, now, President Obama, the big president, and if there was a real president, I mean, really, if it was born, it's going to be if. So the executive orders he has, and those of his predecessors on file, George Bush, all the way back to 1916, including FDR, yes, that's the right question. They're called, these orders were called, we have war powers act in 16 with the Wilson, FDR, we had the Emergency Powers Act, and he kept on changing a war began to it, and including 10 weeks, several. One was federal prisoners, incarcerated federal prisoners, to be shot. And then we get to the war to get rid of them. Because they're a problem. And there's so much down here about us in concentration camps, slave labor, confiscation of our property, a city deposit box, money, cash, vehicles, everything, infrastructure. And there's no end to it. And so Obama's, you know, I don't know what's going to take him out of office. I've seen the CIA has been arrested after that trial. You know, for a trial. CIA can try it, and of course the media is all news blackout about that. And we want to see the news. And that's courtesy David Rockefeller, the late 60s, and that's to be with the Trial Commission. He really got taxed in 73, and right now he runs Bilderbergs, and that's moved to China. And as well as Henry Kissinger over there, they're golfing buddies out there at their age, which is good. They can do it, but they're getting a different health plan than we have. But so, I just the idea of kicking back. I know, really not such really massacre, you know, but rather, you know, music could be used after the BRICS banks and the effect here in the U.S. The war gone, it didn't happen, the bomb's gone, and we kind of changed our society or rebuild the foundation back to where it was at the turn of the last century. 1900 is not that cold. Maybe 1800s when that was all beginning to happen. This would work, you know.
Yeah.
That sounds good. I really know very little about music.
Good.
So it sounds good and you feel it's someone out. Thank you.
Thank you.
Listen to a lot of it. It definitely helps the soul in the fight we're in.
You're right. When it's stressful, I gotta hear that music.
Yeah, that's
right.
That's right. Listen to it. That's right.
Fight music.
That's exactly right. Good.
I had one question. On this like modern day music, you know, you have this idea being deprived from you, like from like an early age. So from a standpoint that, you know, a kid growing up, he's already deprived of, you know, knowing himself or something. Because I guess the interesting thing about music is that I think everybody can agree that everybody likes music, for the most part. I mean, I'm sure there's probably some exceptions, but it's part of living, part of society. And I just had a question of, you know, somebody listening to, you know, modern music and then going, trying to get around the classical music. It's would you explain it as like a way of re-identifying oneself?
Yeah, because music isn't just like Mindy said. It's not a form of entertainment. It's not something that we do on the side that we tend to like, but that it's an expression of our identity as a human species. It's how you express a sense of love for mankind. And a sense of actual compassion. But yeah, it's exactly, you can always re-identify yourself. Mm-hmm. We're not determined by past experiences. We're not an accumulation of past experiences. That's a very good thing. Because the only constant thing is actual change. But in what direction do you want to change? How do you want to change? To better oneself? To better society? Yeah.
You know, it's interesting on that. It's not, we're not a religious organization, but it's the idea of the why you're supposed to death zone. Because the idea of this confessional and the deathbed type thing, you always have that potential to change. You never know. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's a concept where it's an optimistic concept.
Yeah, absolutely.
You transform your whole identity in 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
It could be the last second, or it could be
right.
much earlier. But if that's the concept, it's a philosophical concept. A truth to it.
Right.
Yeah, Vance?
Well, I was going to say that life without music would be beyond madness, beyond chaos.
Amen.
Because music is, it shows our identity, mm-hmm. so that
yeah.
we're here, we're alive, and we relate to the music.
Mm-hmm.
Music calms us down, it calms our emotions down, it also links to one of oneself too. So it depends which music you're into, and because there are different notes that triggers your emotions, your the balance of your body, of your human self, your body. There are like rock or metal. There's some like causes some chemical imbalance.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
When you go to the music and you see
any studies on that.
The calmer music, like classical, whatever, it makes your body become balanced and it does something to your
yeah.
to yourself.
Like, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I guess I can thank the people online. They're probably off now. We're probably gonna say sayonara from here.
Okay.